texts. The first one I've got is the Christian norm. This question: the Christian norm seems to be raising safe kids who become safe adults who are no threat to the works of the devil. I see the followers of Christ eating danger for breakfast. So what happened to us? How would you say, raising kids, raising generations in the delight of the Lord is relevant to that?
Yeah, I would say basically safety is a good thing depending on what you're talking about. We ought to be safe from certain things and ought not to be safe from others. So a child should be safe when from explosions of anger from dad. A child should be safe from child molesters up and down the street. A child should be safe from ungodly instruction from people who don't love God. He shouldn't receive it. You know, there are certain things that you... You want to protect your kids growing up, just like you want to feed them and clothe them. Protection of children is not a bad thing, but it's the protection of boot camp, right? You don't have a high mortality rate in boot camp because it's a safe place. It's drill. They're all drills. They're exercises. The whole point is to equip soldiers for the war. Right, and everybody in the boot camp knows that that's what this is. So, after my time here, I'm going out there, and out there, it's a live fire, exercise. And the place I would go in Scripture to illustrate that would be, blessed is the man. The Psalm 127. So the man is blessed with children. And it says, blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them. Well, what's a quiver full of? Arrows, weapons of war. So Psalm 127 is not talking about the patter of little feet around the house. That's a lot of fun, right? Jammy rides are fun. Putting kids to bed is fun. There's a lot of horsing around that's fun. But the end result of the blessing is... the man who has his quiver full of them will not be ashamed when he contends against his enemies in the gate. Well, that's referring to your political enemies. The gate is the city council. So when you stand up at city council, not only do you have reinforcements on your side, but they're your own children, and they're on your side. They are in the battle with you. And when they're in the battle with you, there are risks that go with the battle. For them as well as for you, right? You might be a martyr. They might be a martyr. You might have your career shot to pieces. They might have their careers. You shouldn't want your children to be safe in that way. You want them to be safe from all the things that would interfere with the training.
Doug, you talked a little bit about what the hammer falling looks like. Could you talk a little bit more about... maybe like when your father gave you those three rules, what are the consequences for disobedience look like when you were younger and then maybe when you were older as well?
Let me just, this is something that Nancy and I did occasionally. You know how it is when in the hurly-burly of life, sometimes the standards get a little raggedy and after 3 weeks you realize, okay, this got away from us. I remember one time calling the kids in for a family meeting, and I had them line up in front of me and said, okay, kids, things have gotten a little raggedy. I'm just letting you know that we're tightening up. We're going to have what I call a reign of terror. there will be no warnings. It just gave everybody one fair warning that we're going to tighten this up. So that works, and they were all elementary age or younger, I think, at that time. That kind of thing, you just explain, we're all in this family together, this is what we're doing, this is the adjustment we're going to have to make. When I was younger, the age when my father laid down those rules to me, I was of an age where I would still get spankings. I believe that, let me just lay it out this way. This was my experience. This is what we sought to do with our kids. I think 90% of all the spankings that a kid gets should be when they're five and younger. You know, 90% of all their spankings that they'll ever receive are when they're little, and they're little kid spankings, swats, right? And then as they are getting, as they get older, I think, I don't think a child should be spanked after they're 11 or 12 or so, right? I think that if you're doing it right, that the spankings are going to taper off. And here's how it works. What you're doing is when they're 18 and they go to college, or when they're 18 and they join the Navy, and when they're 12, they're just 6 years away from that, right? You need to be gearing up for the time when they're out of your home. And when they join the Navy and they're in the Philippines, you're not going to be able to spank them, right? So you have to phase your way toward that. And so what happens is, what should happen is you're phasing spankings out and gradually replacing them with what I call real world consequences. When they're 18, 19, 20, they're going to be out in the real world, and when they show up late for work 7 days in a row, they face real world consequences. They lose their job. The consequences are financial or time restrictions, and you know, that sort of thing, or restitution. So I think parents ought to have the bulk of spankings when children are little, and I'd call them spankings, swats, and then you occasionally have them periodically. And with all three of our children, we had overwhelming when they were little, and then as they approached their, I think it was 11 to 13, somewhere in that area, we said, okay, we don't want to spank after this point, because now you're assaulting sort of their budding adulthood. You're insulting, you know, it's, and you should be able to maintain control without that. So I would put in real world consequences. Son, you're going to have to pay for that. You're going to have to mow the lawn a couple of extra times to reimburse your sister. You know, real world consequences. So if your grades tube, if you're just goofing off, you don't take away the video games because you're trying to take away something that's fun. You take away the video games until you bring your grades up. You know, it's that sort of real time consequences. A man reaps what he sows. Many Christian parents, when kids are little and sin is relatively cute, a kid falls down, does a flop in Walmart because he didn't get the toy he wants, the world doesn't end, and a lot of parents manage without dealing with sin sharply when it's little and cute. They indulge and indulge and indulge. And then when the child gets to be 12, 13, 14, and can actually get pregnant or get somebody pregnant or buy drugs or do something serious, the parents go, ah, and then clamp down a bunch of rules. What you should be doing is all the rules should be early and strictly early and strictly enforced. And as the kids are growing, you should be taking rules off. The fundamental rule is no disobedience, but you're removing standards. So by the time they're 16, you should say, we trust you, honey. Right? And if that is wildly abused, then you have another conversation. But you can generally know if the child, by the time a child's 15 or 16, you should be able to have a good grasp of whether they've internalized the standard.
Okay. One of the questions here, I think I'll unbonify it a little bit, but we live in a world cursed by sin and death, and not everybody's able to have a nuclear family, mom, dad, with right. The kids. A lot of single parents, especially in our culture today, there's a lot of divorce, and there's believers in the church. They come in, or this happens while they're believers. So how are we able to maintain these kind of standards and parent in a godly way in those kind of situations?
Okay, so the question basically is, even in the Christian church, you've got families that are not the ideal. Dad left, or you've got a single mom for some reason, or dad bringing up children, or, whatever. The first thing you first you play cards with the hand you're dealt, right? God takes you from where you are, not from where you should have been. So God's standards should be applied where you are, not where you should have been. And oftentimes, single moms are in that position through no fault of their own. You know, someone betrayed them. Someone deserted them. And so you say, well, you know, when you talk about dad doing this and mom doing that, and, you know, and then there's a single mom here, and she's just aching because she doesn't have that. How can we make that ache go away? Well, you can't make the ache go away by telling her lies, right? It's like someone losing a limb. If they lose a leg, you can't make anything better by saying, well, one leg is just as good as two. It's not, right? If you're going to have to make do. You're going to have to get a crutch or a prosthetic. You're going to have to do something to adjust to this reality. And the body of Christ should labor to help people in that position to adjust to it and to do makeshift things that, you know, get an uncle involved, you know, as a mentor for this boy, or, you know, you look at the situation and you look at who's available to help. You look at the pitfalls, and, you know, there's all kinds of possibilities. But don't tell lies, and do the best you can, and trust God's promises. You know, God's promises. In 1 Corinthians 7:14, it says that the child is holy if one parent is a believer, and God's promises can be applied even in those hard circumstances. But don't pretend it's not hard, and don't pretend it's not an additional obstacle. It manifestly is. We have a single mom in our church who was betrayed by her husband, and a bitter court battle, and she and her kids are in the public school by court order, right? So so that's a tough one, right? But she's doing very well, and she's trusting God, and her kids love the Lord, and it looks good, but it's tough.
Could you give just a brief overview of the proper mechanics of spanking? How do we do
that? I would love to. Do we have a volunteer? Do I have a volunteer toddler? No. So, first, let me say what it's not. It is not picking up a toddler who's not yet potty trained and giving him a whomp on the diapers. You pick him up and boom. That's not a spanking. That's not a swat. Oftentimes, little boys will, Papa's so silly. Basically, a spanking ought to sting, not damage. When you spank a child, it should be on the bare buns. It should not be clobbering the kid. You should not be spanking in such a way as to leave any kind of permanent marks. You are stinging, not clubbing. What we generally used was a wooden spatula or wooden spoon, something like that. And I think an appropriate spanking is all in the wrist. So now, if it's this, if you strike with the hand, if you spank a child with your hand, oftentimes it will sting your hand as much as it stings the child, and then the parent is tempted to get mad because it hurt me too. So you want to keep it calm and judicial, and I would say normally, routinely, it should be, unless it's some extraordinary event, normally, routinely, it ought to be three or four swats like that, okay?
Okay, let's see, we got one here. We could probably about 10 more minutes of questions. How did the situation, or how did things change, or application of discipline, of applying standards in situations like mental retardation, fetal alcohol syndrome, things like that, where there's physical or mental illness involved in little children? You know, like how would you discipline a child with autism, for example?
Right. So if you're dealing with medical conditions, physiological realities, fetal alcohol syndrome is a real, it's a real thing. It's not just, that's not a psychobabble thing. Autism is a real thing, not just psychobabble. You've got real situations. And Christians ought not to just dismiss them and say, oh, that's just secular talk. I think those realities have to be taken into account. At the same time, an autistic child is in a position to have his life go very, very badly. Fetal alcohol syndrome child can have their life go very badly. And your job as a parent is to head off everything you can head off. Also, on top of this, you have the additional complications. Oftentimes, Christian parents with fetal alcohol children, it's not just that, but it's also adopted. The child is adopted. Or if it was a crack cocaine baby, or, you know, that sort of thing. And you've got all sorts of additional issues. And so what you're trying to do is say, okay, I want to take this as far in the right direction as I can, given where I started. Okay? So I don't think you should just simply apply the same standard across the board as you would with, let's say you've got three kids of your own and one adopted child, and the adopted child has all sorts of extraordinary needs. Remember what I said about discipline and punishment? So if it's punishment, if it's abstract justice, it's three swats for the same thing for every kid. Well, no, you don't do that with your own kids. It's discipline. You don't put, if you've got a little boy who is just like Pigpen out of Peanuts, you don't make his sister stay in the tub the same amount of time that he has to stay in the tub in the interests of justice. How long do they have to stay in the tub? Well, as long as it takes to get them clean. Right? The point is to get them clean. So if you have a little tank of a boy who can take a beating, and I remember as a boy, it was I took it as a personal challenge, a personal goal, personal life improvement goal, to see how far I could go in a spanking without crying. Okay? So I admitted the justice of the proceedings, right? I didn't have any complaint about the justice, but I was going to be a man. And I'm not going to, and I wasn't trying to define my dad. I was just wanting to be masculine. I didn't want to be a sissy. So I wanted to take it. And so if parents say, okay, and then you have a little girl, and dad looks at her sideways, and she bursts into tears and repents. And it's genuine repentance, right? It's genuine repentance. You don't spank her at the same level you had to spank her brother, in the interests of justice. The whole point is correction, right? The point is to get them on the right path. And you want to make, and if you have a special needs child, you want to be simply monitoring constantly whether this is helping or not, right? You don't want to spank a child just enough to make them mad and not enough to do anything worthwhile. So I can't give a here's a one-size-fits-all answer. I can say that with special needs children, special attention and special modifications ought to be made. But they ought not to be made, you know, they ought not to be made in a way that just allows kids with special needs to ruin their lives. I also would say to Christian parents, count the cost before, when you're adopting, count the cost. Understand that it's not just a feel-good moment. I've seen many adoption situations go sadly wrong because the parents didn't read the sort of the spiritual fine print.
I've got a few questions along the same lines about the fact that that we should not discipline in anger. It should be judicial. But then you see how God dealt with Israel, and you see, you know, again and again, they roused him to anger, and then he bring, he disciplines them.
Right. When God is roused to anger with his people, overwhelmingly in Scripture, it is at the point of what we would call disinheritance. Right. When he's going to, so it's either disinheritance or virtual disinheritance.
Yeah, the son in Deuteronomy who the parents bring before, the disobedient son that they bring before to be stoned to death.
Yeah, right? Yes. Yeah. So you have, those are extreme situations. So I don't want to say that a parent can never be angry, right? I want to say that when a parent is angry, that anger should model the Lord's anger, which means that there's a rejection going on. Does that make sense? So it's not that. Let me distinguish. I think that kind of anger is going to be very different than losing your temper. Right? So let's say a kid bumps, trips, and falls into the coffee table, and dad blows up. That is just, man's anger does not serve God's righteousness, it says in James. Okay? But let's say a 15-year-old boy comes home and tells dad, I got a girl, I got Susie pregnant. I think a godly anger can be appropriate, a godly constructive anger can be appropriate at a significant sin like that. But it should be mingled with a father's anger. There should be mingled with repentance and other godly attributes where the son doesn't feel like dad's just blowing up or dad's just losing it. When Jesus got angry, the one place it says in Scripture where Jesus got angry, it's not the cleansing of the temple, although he probably was angry there. It doesn't say it. The one place it says he got angry was in Mark, when they were looking at whether he would heal the man with a withered hand or not. And Jesus looked around at their hardness of heart and got angry. But when Jesus got angry, the end result was a healed hand. And when we get angry, if there's a hole in the sheetrock, it just doesn't. It's not the same thing.
Okay. This is a good one. How do you react when an adult child, either adult child out of the home or one just nearing adulthood, so not a young one anymore, starts to veer from the faith? What should a Christian parent do?
Okay. When they start to veer from the faith, if they veer from the faith as soon as they have at the first opportunity, right, first semester at college, if they're going, the chances are outstanding that they were veering from the faith for some years before that. And so I would say parents should begin that process with a spiritual inventory, What did we miss when he was still in our home? I don't think it's a natural inclination that parents have in that circumstance to say, what did we do wrong? But it's more a rhetorical question, and their job is to say, what did we do wrong? And it's everybody else's job to say, nothing, you did everything you could. And, okay, but now we still have this. Oftentimes, parents did neglect something, they did miss something. And so if a child veers from the faith at the first opportunity, what they should do is some soul searching first, and then reaching out second, and not reaching out in anger, but reaching out in with questions. What's your thinking? How can we pray for you? That sort of thing. Instead of coming at them where they would have all their defenses up. If they depart from the faith, let's say, 5 years into their marriage, after college, that sort of thing, then I think parents should start praying about asking God to reveal to them what the real issue is. And it's probably something hidden. So, for example, if a husband of 5 years starts veering from the faith, he's out of college, he's 29 years old, and he starts saying things, I'm not sure I believe in God anymore. I think the parent should be praying, God, what's her name? Something else is going on.
Thank you, Doug.
Thank you
very much.